you hear the words Carol Vorderman, you probably think maths, beauty, brains, glamour, celebrity. What you don't think is a lot of heartache, a lot of soul searching, a lot of tears.
I'd just like to say, well, this will be the first time I'll ever have spoken about a lot of things on television.
Father having nothing to do with her, two failed marriages, the terrible death of her colleague, Richard Whiteley.
I'm really looking forward to the interview. I think it will lay quite a few demons to rest for me.
The thing about Carol Vorderman is she's quite bossy.
It'll be strange being in a television studio and not being in charge.
Well, tonight, Carol, I'm in charge. That was quite an ovation, Miss Vorderman.
Thank you so much. Thank you. You make me feel really at home.
What do you think your public perception is?
Oh, heck. I think it varies from that old bird who does sums to a northern woman who works hard and has got a couple of kids. I think it kind of comes
somewhere. Well, let's take the sums one first, because I've always had this sneaking suspicion it's all just a total scam.
Oh.
And there's either somebody in your ear giving you all the answers or whatever.
Of course.
And I'm sure I'm right, so I'm going to test you. What is 9 times 75 minus 50 plus 6?
631.
God, yes. Here's the second one.
What
is 23,800 divided by 25?
952.
Oh, damn it!
Is that right?
Yes.
Faster, I would have done
it. No, I thought I had you. It's going to be a great moment of television, but unfortunately, you rallied strongly. Final one. Can you work out how many sums you've solved on television in your entire career?
On Countdown, let's say that was 2 or 3 multiple. I would say it's around about 11,000, 12,000.
11,200 sums.
Yeah.
You've done on television. Isn't that amazing?
It's a lot of sums.
Do you find that everywhere you go, people do what I just did to you? They just try and trip you up ask you sums.
Restaurants, particularly, you know, oh, can you split the bill? No, I can't. You pay for it or I'll pay for it. That's the way it's going to be.
Now, you've had 2 great accolades, I would say, in your life. The government picked you as their maths czar, an amazing honour. And in 2011, you compiled a report on maths.
Yes, that was working with a lot of people who are heavily involved in maths and science education. And those who teach the children who really struggle, because I'm most concerned with those, not in the top 15%, not right at the bottom, but kind of 75% chunk.
Be honest, did that accolade, or the one I'm about to read out, mean more to you? Because you were also picked as Rear of the Year.
Definitely the maths.
I just don't believe you. Well, there we have it. I mean...
That's hilarious. That's a joke.
Your Rear, for want of a better phrase, given you that is the title, has become the matter of sort of national obsession. How do you feel about this?
I think it's funny. It's funny because it's huge.
When you first heard you won that title, though, I mean, a little part of you must have been like,
no.
Well, what are you going
to do? I laughed myself senseless.
Carol Vorderman, let's just see just how far you've come in your 30-year career.
That's 870.
Brains plus beauty plus 5,000 hours of television equals the winning formula that is Carol Vorderman.
8 to 7 to 1.
She's getting even better, isn't she?
I only got it in the last few seconds.
When you turn countdown on, it was like watching your old friends. And you always try to do the maths. And then you'd go, I wonder if Carol's going to get it. And she always did. And everybody always went, oh, isn't she clever? That's brilliant.
Take it away. 297 to 1.
I mean, for crying out loud, who can make numbers sexy? I mean, really, maths sexy?
She's an institution. She's part of the fabric of the nation. And she's a telly legend.
Carol was just 21 years old when she appeared on Channel 4's first ever programme.
Meet our vital statistician, Carol Vorderman. She's a Cambridge graduate and she works in computers.
Soon, millions were tuning in. Carol came from humble beginnings. At just 3 weeks old, she was abandoned by her father, Tony, and was brought up by her single mother, Jean, in a small seaside resort in North Wales. But brainy Carol grew up brimming with drive and ambition. She got a place at Cambridge University and went on to become the highest-paid woman in British television.
There are daytime fees, and then there is Carol Vorderman's fee. And I don't think it's ever been matched before or since.
Is 675.
But Carol wasn't just good at maths. She's become one of TV's national treasures, presenting more than 50 different shows.
It's Friday. It's 8 o'clock. We are live on ITV. We are Find a Fortune. And you started modelling when a then-boyfriend sent a photograph. This is Loose Women Live. I'm Carol Vorderman, the new girl on the block.
But for a generation of viewers, Carol's finest half hour will always be Countdown.
Long way to go. 871.
And the key to his popularity was Carol's remarkable on-screen relationship with its anchorman, Richard Whiteley.
I was going to call you...
Carol Vorderman.
She said it. Carol Vorderman.
Even Richard's partner referred to Carol as his TV wife.
She could take the mickey out of him. But likewise, he could take the mickey out of her.
No, it's Friday, Richard.
It's not. It's Monday today. Oh, it's Friday today.
Outside the studio, they had partners. But inside the studio, there was a kind of intimacy. It was the best kind of love affair, you know? All the excitement, but none of the touching. Whoa, great.
But after an incredible 23 years presenting together, in June 2005, Richard Whiteley contracted a virus and died suddenly. Carol was distraught. Her grief was captured in the moving eulogy she recorded as an introduction for Richard's final programmes.
Hello, Countdowners. I know we're all in a state of shock about the very sad news about Richard. And, you know, it's really odd to think that the man who's been here, the mayor in the chair for 23 years, won't be here anymore. Remember him as we remember him, and the clock stopped too soon.
She delivered those lines to camera, and the moment she finished, she broke down in tears. It was absolutely heartbreaking to see. It was such a brave thing for her to do.
It was the first loss, I think, that Carol had had, major loss in her life, and she was absolutely devastated by it. Broke her heart.
Is she?
Even now, it's obviously incredibly emotional for you.
Yeah. I loved him.
Sorry. How did you hear the news that he'd died?
Our exec producer rang. Kathy had rung Claire, who was our boss, and I was at home. I lived in London at the time, and I knew he'd gone in for his operation. He had a heart operation, and I'd spoken to Kathy immediately after, and she said it was the first bit of good news that we'd had the day before, which was that that the surgeon had thought the operation had gone very well and hadn't taken as long as they'd thought. And that was the first time in about 6 weeks that I kind of felt that there was anything to feel joyous about. And then the next day I didn't hear anything. I was at somewhere, somebody's house, and I was shaking with nerves, and I just kind of, I was just worried about him. And then I was at home, and the kids gone to bed, and Claire rang to say. But it still hurts, but you can tell very much. I mean, I get, you know, I loved him. I really loved him.
He really was one of the nicest people.
He's fantastic.
I mean, it's an old cliche, but he was just, I met him a couple of times. He was just Mr. Nice Guy, wasn't he?
He was more than just nice. He was funny, funny, funny. And, you know, like we were saying in the North, you belly laugh together. And every time we were in the studio together, I would cry laughing at some point. It was just a complete and utter joy to be with him, and we loved each other, really. Not in that way, it was, you know, just a genuine, pure thing. He was just wonderful. And when Richard died, there was just some strange, very strange coincidences that happened. Just strange things he said for the first time ever. And you've got to remember, we'd done nearly 5,000 programs together. He said, "Welcome to the final countdown." And I went mad from my end. "Don't you dare say that." And he said, "Oh, I mean, ha, 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 the countdown final." And I did. I just didn't like it. And then the conundrum came up, the word falsified, but the way they jumbled it up to give to the contestants was "life fades." And it was just a... And that was his last programme. It was just, yeah, it was quite extraordinary because it, I know they're only coincidences, but it was just, it was a horrible time and a lot of grief.
What kind of guy was he, for those who didn't know him?
Richard. Well, let me tell you, he was funny, funny, funny. He was a bit pompous in the early years, and he said, and I can remember the first time I insulted his jackets. Do you remember he used to wear those terrible jackets?
Terrible jackets!
Red, green and yellow stripe, and then he'd wear a check shirt underneath and a spotted tie, and he thought that was normal.
Everything wrong.
Everything wrong. He loved playing the buffoon. I mean, he was an intelligent guy, as you know, but he always tripped himself up, and there were things that he did and he didn't mean to do. So it was a classic time when he wore ties. People used to send him in god-awful ties. I mean, really awful ties. Anyway, this lady, for our Christmas special, however many years ago it was, sent him in a tie, and she painted... He said, "Gorgeous, look at this tie. This is outside. Look at this. How beautiful this tie is. Silk. It's dark green silk, and she's painted on countdown in these gorgeous letters, countdown, all the way down this tie. And look, and there's a Christmas tree there, and I'm going to wear it on the special program." Oh, marvellous, marvellous. So we recorded the programme, and Richard wore this tie, pointed it all out, and it was marvellous. Anyway, the programme went to air and was transmitted the next day. Whiteley, in swearing shocker. And what had happened, it said countdown, he sat behind the desk, the down had disappeared, and his microphone had gone over the O. And we did the whole show.
I remember that. That was a classic story.
Absolute classic.
Fabulous.
Only Whiteys.
Did your real father ever tell you he loved you?
No.
Let's go back to where it all started. You were born to Tony and Jean Vorderman in Bedfordshire in 1960. The youngest of three children. And an extraordinary thing happened very early in your life. You were 3 weeks old when your father leaves home.
Well, my mum left. My mum left him. She found herself with nothing. There really wasn't money around.
And your father paid no maintenance,
so she was left. He wouldn't pay maintenance. No, he would not pay maintenance until she took him to court. And so we slept, you know, four in a room. It was a little two-bedroom flat, and I slept with my mum until I was nine. We shared a bed together, and...
How poor were you? Put it in perspective.
There was no money. So mum, after a couple of years, she had about four part-time jobs, and there was no money. You know, we grew up on chips. There was always a chip pan on the top of the stove. And my grandfather, who had been a farmer, he would always bring a sack of potatoes and eggs. Mm. And that was fundamentally what we were brought up on, was chips
and you literally
eggs.
You had one bath a week between
them. We had one bath a week with this horrible little kind of lean-to bathroom, which was freezing cold. I remember mum saving up once for a frozen chicken. And she said, oh, yes, we're going to have this frozen chicken next Sunday. And I'm saving all this money. So she did. And, oh, we're going to have the frozen chicken. You know, we're going to have the frozen chicken next week. So come the Sunday, she's got the frozen chicken. And she defrosted it the night before. And she put it, the whole big palaver, put this frozen chicken into the oven. And, so exciting. And then about half an hour later, it was a terrible smell from the kitchen. And she'd left the giblets in the plastic bag in the chicken and put them in the oven. And she was so upset. She'd saved all the money for this chicken and she just cried. It was one of the few times that I saw my mum cry.
Awful for
her. Yeah, and that was, you know...
Your mother, she remarried.
Yes, she did.
You were 10 years old. She married Gabriel, your stepfather. Yep, Gabriel. Tell me about him.
Gabriel was fantastic. I called him Dad, and I adored him. He was just larger than life and swore all the time, and he was Italian, and he'd come over as a prisoner of war, and he was a builder, and he had a small building firm. Catty, he used to call me. Catty, you bitch, you come sit here. I'd have to go and sit there. And you go in the pickup truck with him, you know, it's because he's a builder. And you drive uptown in Denby, and he knew everybody in town. So the doctor would be walking past, and he'd go, Dr. Gwynne, you bastard. And I'd go, Dad, shut up. And he'd always say, you bring a bloody boyfriend home, I bloody shoot the bastard. He used to say he never had a gun. But, God, he was always threatening to shoot people.
A great character, but also a bit of a naughty boy.
He was a bit of a naughty boy.
And he had a lot of affairs that really upset your mum, and eventually she had enough, and that was it. After moving out and moving back
in. My mum left him. We argue about how many times she actually left him in the 10 years that they were together. I say it's five, she says it's four. So the first time she left him, I was 10. We went to Leicester and we stayed in this one room in this kind of really run-down B&B. And I had this teddy bear that I've always had called Bungie. And you have to remember, I was small then. And I remember saying to her, Bungie doesn't have a home anymore. And she said, oh, it broke my heart when you said that.
You had a rocky start in life, but your mum was determined that you would become a success. Carol Jean Vorderman was born on Christmas Eve in 1960, the third child to Jean and Tony. When Carol was just 3 weeks old, her father dropped a bombshell. He was having an affair with the 16-year-old daughter of a friend of the family. So Carol's mother took her three children to live in Prestatyn in North Wales, where she'd grown up. She told her children their father was working away.
For about a year, I didn't know they'd separated. But my mum used to cry a lot, and she was very thin.
Jean and her children settled into a two-bedroom flat, and life was a struggle.
I went on national assistance benefits. In those days, it was a stigma to be on national assistance. I mean, a real disgrace. And I thought, I'm determined I'm not staying on this. And that's when I started working.
And she worked really, really hard, doing four or five jobs to keep us going.
Carol's father sometimes visited her brother and sister in Prestatyn, but refused to see Carol. His rejection of his youngest daughter was total.
He came to meet Trixie and Anton. They were at school. And I went along there, Carol in a little pushchair. And he was there in a huge Jaguar car. And they got in the back of the car. And they waved to me from the window. It really broke my heart.
As a child, Carol would never meet her father.
I can see that Carol felt rejected and abandoned, really.
Eventually, Tony stopped visiting and family life in Prestatyn got on without him. Carol didn't let the troubles of her childhood hold her back. She was ambitious and worked hard to be a grade A student, later graduating from Cambridge University in 1981. It was when she moved to Leeds with her mother that Jean spotted an ad in the local paper.
They were looking for a girl to be a hostess for this new programme that was coming out called Countdown. I said to Carol, you're good at sums, you can do this. And she wasn't a bit interested, so I did sneak and type this letter. Dear Mr. Mead, if it's brains and beauty you want, addition is no problem, and enclose a recent photo for you to judge the second qualification. And when I showed it to her, she said, oh, I'm not signing that. So I signed it and forged her signature, quite a good one, and sent it off.
Carol beat 3,000 applicants to land the job, and in 1982, Countdown launched on our screens.
I'm 93.
I took Carol aside in the canteen and I said to her, you're a very bright girl. You went to Cambridge. This is a short-term proposition. You have no future in television. Take it from me. And regularly, Carol texts me to thank me for my career advice.
The show became an enormous hit and Carol was a household name. At its peak, 4 million people were tuning in. And Carol's father, who she'd still never met, was one of them.
My father did watch Carol on Countdown and followed her career quite closely.
When she was 42, Carol decided it was time to meet her father.
Carol and I walked into the room and he stood up and he was an elderly man. And he put his arms round her and they had a hug And I think everybody just cried.
Carol and her father had 5 years together before he died in 2007.
I think it did solve a lot of issues for her. I do. Yes.
Mm. Wow. What an extraordinary story. So you're 3 weeks old. Your father has an affair with a 16-year-old girl whose mother had been taking care of the kids while your mum was in hospital. It's about as messy as it can be. And then, for whatever...
I didn't know anything about that.
No, I mean, this is all stuff you found out later.
Yeah.
But what you did know was that he just disappeared from your life. I mean, he rejected
he
you.
He didn't want anything to do with me, and he saw it throughout most of my life, you know, nothing, absolutely nothing. And yet he saw my brother, and he could sometimes go and stay with my sister. He remarried, and then when I was getting married the first time, I said to Mum, right, I'm going to invite him to the wedding. And she said, OK, darling, I've got his number. Obviously, we knew where he was. I'll ring him. And she rang and said, oh, Carol would like to invite you to her wedding. And he just said, no.
Which, was it callousness?
And at that point, I thought, right, that's it. As you would, wouldn't you? That's it. You know, I'm not having anything to do with him again.
What was motivating this rejection from his side?
I don't know. I still don't know. I still don't know. I don't
understand
hurtful. It. It is very hurtful, and it does have an effect. It's still, you know, not that I think about him all the time, because he was never a part of my kind of everyday life. So his influence really has been something, almost by not being there, he was influential, if that makes sense. And he wrote me a letter when his second wife died, and he said to my sister that he was going to write me a letter, and this letter came through the postbox, and the letterbox, and I could see that it was from Bedford, and I could see it was handwriting I didn't know, and I never opened it.
Never read it?
Never read it. I was 30. I did the classic return to sender, went outside, popped it through a red letterbox, a pillar box, and I thought, nope, you've had your chances, mate, and then I changed my mind 10 years later. But maybe I was wrong doing that, but I just felt so utterly rejected, and you feel humiliated as well, because you think, what have I done wrong? What, you know, and I hadn't done anything wrong, that's the truth of it.
You were a three-week-old baby.
How could I have done anything wrong?
When you finally met him...
Yeah.
Talk to me about what made you do that.
I've got two children, Katie and Cameron, and they'd started asking about a granddad. They didn't know a granddad, really. And I just thought, well, you know, it's not really for me to deny them that. So that's really what motivated it, to be honest.
And when you walked through the door?
Well, I was very nervous. I was sort of, you know, when you get nervous and you go, ah, and you kind of go, oh, yes, everything's very light-hearted, and then it goes, ooh, because I didn't know how to deal with it. And then I walked through and he was there, and as Trixie said, you know, he was now an old man, and I thought, all those wasted years is actually what I thought. And I wasn't upset by it, but I just thought, you know, sometimes, and it's partly my fault, his fault initially, yes, my fault when I was 30 for not opening the letter. And so there was no point going back over it. I didn't want to know. I think I didn't ask the why he'd rejected me, because I didn't want to know the answer.
Did he apologise?
No, and I didn't ask him to.
Never apologised?
No, but I think sometimes... I don't think it would have helped either of us to go there.
Did your real father ever tell you he loved you?
No. No.
Extraordinary.
Yeah. But, you know, I just think that having Mum as a mum has more than made up for that, and maybe I wouldn't have had the drive that I've had had I not been brought up and had that rejection.
I mean, strange that he would watch you on Countdown.
I know.
And yet not be able to talk to you. Or not want to talk to you.
Not want to talk to me. I don't know. It seemed to change when his second wife died. Maybe, I don't know, there was something going on there. I don't know. But, but I regret not reading the letter. I should have read the letter.
Does it exist?
I don't know, probably somewhere in the bowels of the post office, but no, it never came to light again.
Your mother's a pretty extraordinary woman, isn't she?
Yeah, she's fantastic.
And you've lived with her pretty much all your
life? Pretty much all my life, yeah. Yeah. And even now, you know, if I go home late, like after this, I'll get home late, I'll go and sleep at my mum's, because Cameron's at my mum's tonight. And so I'll go to my mum's and sleep on the sofa. Such a glamorous life. I adore her. I absolutely adore my mum. She's a very special lady.
She's had two health scares in recent years.
Yes, she has.
She had a diagnosis of ovarian cancer in 2003.
Yeah.
In 2007, doctors found a tumour on her kidney. Did you envisage life without your mum, given...
No, I can't. I can't even go there. Can't even think about it. I can't talk about it. No.
Is everything I'm looking at as nature intended?
Oh, God. I knew you were going to go like that.
You went to Cambridge at 17 to study engineering. Were you
yeah.
going to be an engineer? What was all that about?
well. I have always wanted to be a pilot. That's what I wanted to be.
Really?
Yeah. Always wanted to be a pilot. And even though I'd never actually flown by the time I went to university in any kind of aeroplane, I still knew that that was what I wanted to be. I thought, right, I'm going to get in, I'm going to train with British Airways, and so what's the best thing I can do? Engineering, okay, engineering, and where's the best place I can get it from to get, you know, kind of up my chances all the time? Cambridge, okay, that's what I've got to do. So that was kind of how I arrived at the engineering at Cambridge.
And you were known, apparently, as Boots Vorderman.
Yes, Boots Vorderman.
Why was this?
Because I always, probably for about 6 days out of seven, wore thigh-length leather boots.
Which I would imagine made you rather popular with the male students.
It did. But I never had a boyfriend at Cambridge.
Really?
No.
Well, they must have been queuing up for
Boots
Vorderman.
No, I have boyfriends back home.
Ah, yeah. Not at Cambridge.
No.
Did you enjoy Cambridge?
I did enjoy Cambridge. It was quite different, you know. It was in the 1970s, and I'd been to a comprehensive school. Which had never, nobody'd even applied to Cambridge from that school. And in those days, really their intake was from posh schools or from really good grammar schools.
And you ended up with what is now referred to by Cambridge graduates...
As a Vorderman.
As a Vorderman.
Yeah.
Which is a third-class
third
degree.
Third-class degree.
About as bad as you could possibly have done.
Yeah,
congratulations.
Yeah, thank you.
And this apparently was down to the fact you enjoyed the social side a little more than
side. In fairness, it was down to two things. It was down to... The first thing was that I hadn't had the kind of education that everybody else had had leading up to going to Cambridge. Because they've been to Westminster and all sorts of different schools, and also because I like the social life.
You graduated from Cambridge, you moved to take a job in Leeds, you began going out with this handsome naval officer.
Not for very
Chris
long.
Chris Mather.
Yeah, for weeks.
Well, you went out for 6 weeks and then you get married.
Yeah.
What was that all about?
You tell me. That was, where'd you get that from?
A married couple?
Yeah, well, I think it was probably, the dress was borrowed And that was probably a sign of things. I didn't actually want to get married, to be honest.
Why did you marry him?
Because I felt that I couldn't get out of it. And we met and married very quickly. And I the two men I've really loved in my life, and the first one, we'd been going out on and off for many years. And in the end, it was decided that we weren't going to go out. And I kind of, you know, that classic rebound, like, I'll show you. It was just one of those things that actually shouldn't have happened.
What was great was you then, having gone through this process, you go to probably the most stable possible environment any woman could go to. You go and live with Peter Stringfellow. Ah!
To be more correct, I went to live with his wife, Coral.
Coral, yeah, his
ex-wife. Peter's, ex-wife now.
That must have been quite fun, living with Peter Stringfellow.
It was hilarious. This is in the late 1980s. And I'd started working down in London on the Wide Awake Club. Do you remember that?
Yeah, yeah.
With Timmy Mallett and everybody on the Saturday morning. And at TVAM. And I didn't have anywhere to stay. And a friend of mine knew Coral, and Coral said, because this, you know, there were about 17 bedrooms in this flat, and she said, oh, come and live with me. She's a proper good Yorkshire woman, you see. She said, come and live with me. It was always fascinating, you know, because Coral would kind of collect people into the kitchen, and you never quite knew who'd be there, you know, a Russian pop singer or, you know, whoever. It was kind of this fantastic mix of people, and I loved it. Just love all that.
In 1988, you meet your second husband, Paddy King. Where did you meet him?
I met him at a wedding. And a girlfriend of mine, very good friend of mine from university, and so he was a guest, and I was a bridesmaid at the wedding.
Love at first sight?
Possibly.
Really?
Yeah.
So he was the other guy you've loved in your life?
Yeah.
There have been two, really.
Yeah.
You fall pregnant, and 7 months pregnant, you have a near car accident, and the trauma of this, I think you skidded and nearly crashed the car, and the trauma sends you into labour.
Premature birth,
2 months early.
2 months early.
Pretty scary.
It was very scary. This was 1992, and we'd been married for some time. We'd moved out to Maidenhead. To live in Maidenhead, and was so happy about this pregnancy, you know, our first child together, and she arrived, and that was obviously such a shock.
What did she weigh?
She weighed just over 4 pounds.
Wow, tiny.
Yeah, tiny baby.
But she came home,
she
did great, and then you had another boy, Cameron.
Yeah.
So the family is complete.
Yes.
And then you've got television to get on. In fact, 3 weeks after Cameron's born, you're back on screen.
Yes.
In her 30s, Carol was a happily married working mum of two, and having a glamorous image wasn't the first thing on her mind.
Carol was working very, very hard, and so she used to cut her own fringe, and she didn't really bother.
But as Carol was just about to hit 40, she was suddenly splashed all over the front pages with a stunning new image. On the cusp of middle age, she'd reinvented herself as a sex bomb. She was snapped in a series of revealing dresses, looking, well, let's face it, drop-dead gorgeous.
There were quite a lot of photographs taken, and everybody said, wow, we haven't seen you like that before.
Over a decade later, Carol's looking as stunning as ever.
She's been on television for over 25 years now, and if she didn't think about her image, if she didn't think about what she was presenting to us, we might not be around for her anymore.
It was 51-year-old Carol who got all the attention at this year's National Television Awards.
Those events are full of 17, 18, 22-year-old girls with fresh skin, beautiful looks. Yet on the front pages, it's not them, it's Carol Vorderman.
But not all the press has been flattering. The poison pens have branded Carol a desperate cougar, mutton dressed as lamb, and a fashion countdown to disaster.
There's certain papers that have it in for Carol, and everything she wears, they rip apart. God, I wish I looked like that. Wish I looked like that now, never mind at 51.
It's not just Carol's image that has been making the headlines. As the highest paid woman on TV, in 2000 she was rumoured to be making £3 million a year.
I. Consonant.
Her D-long countdown, most of us would have thought was fictitious, that it was just newspaper talk. It appears it was true.
We think about the large sums of money that Carol was paid, and they were large, but you would pay Carol per show, and she would do almost 350 shows a year for 26 years. That adds up.
When she was the highest paid TV presenter of the mid-90s, it came as no shock to me because of the amount of work that she was doing. She was in everything, you know, Better Homes. You kind of wondered if she was cloned.
But Carol's reign was to end in 2008. With budget cuts across an ailing television industry, Countdown bosses wanted to slash her pay by a rumoured 90%. She decided it was time to leave Countdown.
It was a budget thing. Because you couldn't say that she was failing as a presenter. She wasn't. You know, she was still doing the same job she'd been doing anyway, so it wasn't that. So it was other things.
After 28 years and 4,800 programmes, Carol recorded an emotional final show.
And I'd just like to say, you see, you've started me off now, Jazz. I would just like to say thank you to all of my friends here and in the audience. Sorry.
I think after Countdown, I think the first of all, she was so hurt that she was really bitter about the whole thing. I think she didn't know whether she wanted to carry on.
When Carol left Countdown, it was a very traumatic time for her. And she suddenly just questioned, I think, her whole enjoyment of working in television. She decided that there were other things to do. She moved away from London. She, I wondered at one point whether she'd leave television altogether.
How were you feeling? Is that an accurate assessment from Peter Willis?
Yes, I think so. I think so. I think what it is, I mean, it, you know, fundamentally they said it was about the money. It was kind of 90%. It was the way it was done. Mm. I knew they wanted me out because it was that we were recording and I had a phone call to say, you've got to make your mind. This was about 6 months before my contract was coming to an end. So they said, 90%, you've got to decide within 48 hours. Why?
John Miles, your agent, said, you know, you felt very bitter at the time.
I did feel bitter at the time. Yeah, because I was always terribly loyal to Countdown. And, you know, Whitus and I would always, you know, we kind of led the charge all the time and protected it and protected each other. And that was, you know, more than half of my life. All of my adult life was spent on that programme.
The executives responsible for the show are watching this.
Yeah.
And they extend an olive branch invitation to you. Yeah. Would you go on?
Of course I would.
You are Countdown, right? Wasn't it? Let's talk body parts.
Oh, God.
Because what was definitely noticeable from those pictures was that suddenly this kind of, let's be honest, slight librarian-looking lady from Cambridge suddenly morphs at 40 into this absolute sex vamp.
Really?
Yes! Look at that! That's from GQ. Is everything I'm looking at as nature intended?
Oh, God. I knew you were going to go like that.
Well, I mean, you know, is this au naturel?
What do you think?
I don't know.
Look, if I... All the things that are claimed that I've had done, if I'd had all of those things done, I'd look a damn sight better than I do now. I want a rebate, quite frankly. It's got to such a level now of abuse and lies, quite honestly, that I'm not even going there. I did an article a couple of weeks ago where I said I might possibly, at some point, maybe, if I think about it, in the future, quite might some point think about having an eye lift. Mm. Well, I'm now appearing on cosmetic surgery adverts. It's just ridiculous. So I'm not going to enter into
none of this
that kind of thing. I'm not going to enter into all of that because, no, I'll tell you why. Because somebody asked me some years ago, have you had Botox? And I said, no, I haven't had Botox. So what was the headline? Vorderman denies Botox. So I'm just not even going to enter into the fray.
Is it a huge regret to you, that divorce?
Probably, yeah.
Your second marriage to Paddy, yeah. The father, obviously, of your two
very
children.
Very happy marriage.
Yeah, and it broke down in 2000. Many people were surprised by that. Well, your friends were surprised and so on. You've never really said why you split up.
No, and I forgive me, I'm not going to say it tonight, because I loved Paddy and Paddy loved me, and we had a very, very happy marriage. And, you know, I loved him more than I've ever loved anybody. And a man. And we agreed that we wouldn't talk about it publicly because he's a very private person.
If you hadn't seen your career explode at the time that it did, do you think you would have split up?
Probably not. I think it did have an influence, yeah. Probably we would be together, yeah. Probably.
Are you friends? As friendly as you can be.
Yeah, as friendly as you can be. Yeah, well, I mean, we've got two great kids together, so, that's a good
Is it a huge regret to you, that divorce?
Probably, yeah, probably.
You are a private person, I know that. And you look back over everything you've been through. What do you feel about it all, the life journey you've been on?
My mum always says, do you know, darling, she'll say this tonight when I get back and I'm sleeping on a sofa. And she'll be there in a dressing gown, and I'll be in a little dressing gown, and she'll be in a cup of tea. She said, what was it like? I said, it's all right, mum. And she'll say, oh, do you know what? It's been like something from Arabian Nights, hasn't it? She always says. And she's right.
And it has, hasn't it? When you think back to...
For us.
Four of you in a little box room, in a tiny little place with one bath a week.
Yeah.
And now here you are.
Yeah. I'm very happy. Really happy now. I feel kind of comfortable, in my life now. Yeah.
Now, Carol, whatever life threw at you, it was never going to keep you down. Carol recently turned 50, and she says it's been the best time of her life.
For a large part of Carol's life, she was working, crazy hours, raising the kids, obviously, in a relationship. Now she actually has time to think about herself and have some Carol time, which is what she deserves.
Her 18-year-old daughter, Katie, has followed in Mum's footsteps by getting into Cambridge University. Carol was taken on by the government to advise on teaching maths in schools.
Almost half of children at age 16 fail GCSE maths.
She even beat Pippa Middleton to Rear of the Year. And the Queen of Daytime is back in a new job, hosting Loose Women.
She just wants to have a good old laugh and go out a bit more and have a bit of a party. And Loose Women's the perfect job for her.
I think, in a weird way, Carol's career maybe having just started.
And Carol has declared herself happily single.
Fantastic. I am having a
blast. So you're loving being single?
I actually do, yes. I don't have all that.
I think she's very happy at the moment, and I think she wants to stay that way.
Carol's on her own through choice. She's really enjoying being independent. I don't think she wants to change her life. I think she's happy as she is. Very happy, is she?
So your mum and sister are right then, you are.
I am so happy. Last year was quite an interesting thing because obviously I was, 50 and the previous Christmas Eve. And I had this big party. I waited until the summer and had this big party, and it was just brilliant. And Goxter came, and Alan Carr, who's big buddy, and there were about 200 of us, and then we had this kind of 70s theme, and the swimming pool was open, and all of this kind of stuff going on. It was brilliant. I've never seen as many Afro wigs on the lawn. 6 o'clock the following morning. It was fantastic.
Would you be happy being single for a long time? Or would you rather be in a relationship?
I have always been in relationships, and this is the first time in my life that I can just do what I want, when I want, with whom I want to do it, in whichever way I want to do it.
Just to clarify, what are you doing and with whom?
I'm not going to tell you.
You can share it with us, Carol.
I'm rarely alone. But I, Kate is now at Cambridge. Still got Cameron, got my mum. I live in a much smaller house now. I kind of downsized, not because I needed to financially in any way, but because I wanted to. I don't want things anymore. I don't want all that stuff. Lost the car, got rid of the cars. Don't want all of that. And I want to do things. Mm. And it's lovely because now, doing Loose Women, when we have such a laugh on Loose Women.
It's a good, fun show, Loose
Women. Oh, it's hilarious. It really is. And outrageous. And so even I mean, it's the first time since Richard died that I've had that belly laughing thing. I'd forgotten how much I'd enjoyed being in a studio and forgotten that, that feeling of hosting a live programme. I am as happy as I've ever been. Everybody says it's about the balance, don't they? And I think, finally, I might have it right.
Now, two things I know about you. One is you love presenting.
Yeah.
And you love being bossy.
Yeah.
And tonight you've had to watch me present and be the bossy one.
I know.
How's it felt being on the other end of the experience?
Not as bad as I thought, I have to say.
Well, look, I wish you all the very best.
Thank you.
I really do, and I think it's been great to interview and great to see you back on feisty top form.
Thank you.
Carol Vorderman, thank you very much.
Thank you.
Just had this thought process of how your life was going to go with Kylie, and it was all just being dragged away.
We argued a lot about her wanting to go off and do other things, I think, her independence. I didn't want it. I didn't want... It was jealousy, pure jealousy.